Hello together, my name is Markus Krause and today I want to introduce you to Thread, an IoT home automation network protocol. So don't mix it up, it has nothing to do with threading in the normal programming languages. We mean here it's a quite new network protocol. It's an IPv6 based mesh network technology. Suitable for home automation, industry 4.0, low range sensor actuator applications. It has a low power consumption, the specification you can access freely, and it's founded by Google Nest, Osram and Samsung. And 2018 also Apple joined the group. It's based on the IEEE 802.15.4 protocol, and you can ask, of course, why we need another protocol. There are a lot outside already, and do we really need another one? We have said ZigBee, Z-Wave, or N-Ocean, Bluetooth Low Energy, and I show you that Thread has quite good chance to become a quite popular network protocol. It has, at example, no single point of failure, which sometimes is criticized with ZigBee, at example, even if it's not 100% true with ZigBee, even when the coordinator is not there, the network will still work. Now let's compare Thread with the OC reference model. We see here's two downer layers, the physical and the MAC layer, which are defined from the IEEE standard 802.15.4. The physical layer defines like the modulation and how the signal are coded so that it can reach another module. And the MAC layer add to this addressing so that you can directly send to a device which is in range a message, and we have also securities here implemented, but we don't have a routing mechanism here. This is where Thread come into play. Thread adds this possibility for a mesh network. We're having here 6 LoWPAN. This is to an adaptation layer which allows IPv6 used with IEEE 802.15.4. We have always to keep in mind that the IPv6 package, for example, it has 40 bytes already, the header itself, because of the addresses, and IEEE package are only 127 bytes, and when you add there's like security and you have the header from 40 bytes and so on, then we're having nearly no payload anymore. And this is an adaptation layer which solves this problem. Then we have, of course, IP routing and a few other concepts here in Thread which allow us to use IPv6. Then on the top, we are having typical UDP. Actually, we could also use TCP, but it's only optional, and normally Thread uses UDP for its communication. This means we do not really establish a connection. It's not really reliable, and we need a concept also. We have to confirm our packages by our own, or we're using application layer, and a quite common one is CoAP. I will introduce you later to this too, because it's not really defined in Thread, but it's quite common or planned to use CoAP with Thread. It's also in the free stack, which is available open Thread. It's already implemented, so I will say a few words to CoAP later too. In Thread, we're having two forwarding roles, a router and an antivice. Actually, antivice does not participate on the routing process. Router itself forward packets. It provides services for devices to join the network, and for this it's also necessary that the transceiver is also time on. We see it here with the red circles, these are routers. An end device communicates only with a single router. This means it's parent, and it doesn't make any forwarding, and it's also possible that it disables the transceiver. We're having different device types in Thread. There are full thread devices and minimal thread devices. Full thread devices, or short FTD, has always the radio on, subscribe to all multicast addresses, and maintains IPv6 address mappings. So typical, we have the three devices: a router, router eligible end device, or short read, or full end device. What's the read? This is quite special. I will explain in a minute. Then we're having some minimal thread devices, or short MTD. And there we're having a minimal end device, which has always a transceiver on. So it doesn't need to poll message from its parent. Comparable to SLIS, we have also a sleepy end device, which can turn off the transceiver. But when it wakes up, it has then to ask messages from its parent. And this means the parent, of course, have to maintain, as long as the sleepy end device is sleeping, some messages. A read is a quite interesting device in a thread network. It can either take the role of a router or of a full end devices. We see here, for example, we're having here in this thread network four routers and a lot of end devices, like a sleepy end device, a minimal end device, and a full end device. And here we're having a read. And when now another end device coming in, want to come in the network, and we're having here the read, but it cannot reach the other routers because they're not in range, then the read can be upgraded to a router, and the end device can connect to the network, and the read is now a router and is the parent of this minimal end device. Yeah, now we can of course ask the question, why not always be a router? More is better, it's more stable, and so on. Yeah, yes and no. I mean, we have always, of course, to keep in mind also we're having here embedded system, microcontroller which having not so many resources. More router means also bigger table for routing, so routing tables are become bigger. So we try to keep it as less as possible, and then it's also faster and more reliable. So when the router is not needed anymore, the functionality, it's then also can downgrade the read again to a full end device. But it's really for the stability of the network quite good concept, because when we're having here a malfunction from a router or the connection is not so good anymore, then the read just can upgrade again to a router. We're having two other device roles in the network. A thread leader. There's only one thread leader in one network, or partition called. It's responsible for managing the sets of routers. We will see it later with the addresses, the router having IDs there, and it manages the sets of the ID. The thread leader is dynamically self-elected from the thread network, so it's not clear at the beginning this one is a router or a thread device. It depends on how the network is starting and which one is first, and so on. And when a thread leader loses a connection to a network because of a malfunction, then another device, another router, can become the thread leader. So we don't have here a single point of failure. Then we're having also a border router. Actually, it doesn't need to be one border router. We can have more than one. A border router connects our threat network to another network. So it's like a bridge. An example between the internet. Yeah, we're seeing it here. Here's our border router. Since we're having also IPv6 addresses, it can directly forward addresses from outside to the devices inside and vis-a-vis. Doesn't have to be, of course, the internet. It can also a local area network or even another threat network. I just before mentioned the term partition. Partition is grouped when we're having a threat network and like for here at example, we're having here three routers and the two other routers on this side, they're losing the connection to this group of devices. Then it's split it up into partition A and B. So every partition works for itself and but of course we need for this partition here that it can work another thread leader. So one router becomes then a thread leader and can then work self-dependent. So we're having then partition A and B. They're having still the same parameters, this thread network. And when the connection is back here with this connection or this or both, then the partition merge again, and then one thread leader, of course, becomes a router again. So this makes, again, the network quite stable because even if there is a connection problem, this doesn't mean the whole network is not working anymore. It's just for a short period maybe, and then afterwards it repairs itself again. So the device limits. We're having in thread only the possibility for a maximum of 32 routers. This actually at the beginning I was thinking this is not really much. I explain to you later why we're having only 32 routers. Antivices per routers, we're having a maximum of 511 antivices. This means actually we're having ID is 512, but ID 0 we will see later is reserved. So we're having 511 antivice per routers. So this would mean the maximum of 16,384 devices. When we're having a range from 20 meters per module, then we can calculate a little bit 30 multiplied with 20 meters. It's only 600 meters away. It's a little bit too less for wide range wireless sensor networks. Yeah, but this is only when we are having 20 meters per module, which is actually quite common for a module in a building with concrete or so on. You don't reach much more. So we have still to keep this in mind. So in a big industry a complex or something, it can be already not so a wide range. And for wireless sensor networks, it's a little bit less. But with a range up to 4 kilometers per module, it's already a lot actually. This is nearly the maximum when you're having an amplifier and it's outside. And even with 900 megahertz modules, you could of course going much more far with the distance, yeah. But defined in thread is only from IEEE 2.4 gigahertz. But this doesn't mean you cannot implement the 900 megahertz. It's still possible, which is defined in IEEE. So the possibility for a wide range network is still there. And with amplifier already now and yep, for sure there are later than also modules with 900 megahertz, I think. And also we can, of course, extend our thread network with two thread network, for example, with a border device, it should be possible. The addresses in a network. This is at the beginning a little bit complicated, makes a lot of confusion because we don't have one address. Like in a ZigBee network, we're having There are only two addresses, actually a short address and a 64-bit extended address for every device. And even in the upper layer, we don't change these addresses. We still use these addresses from the MAC layer. But we want to have the IPv6 functionality. So, and for this, we are having quite more, and we need IPv6 addresses. We're having there as a mesh local endpoint identifier. This is an ID, an IPv6 ID for clear identification. We don't choose this. This is actually from the thread implementation, from the stack, self-chosen at the beginning one time, typically. And it doesn't change anymore. But when you reset like the microcontroller and reset everything, then it can become a new one. So it's also not 100% fixed there. So it's a little bit difficult, but we don't choose this normally. And then we're having something which is called routing locator, airlock short. It's a special IPv6 address for routing. And it depends on the network topology. Then we're having a link local address. This is for direct communication with the neighbors, so the range is not so big anymore. And we have a global unicast address, which we can use for communication like in the cloud. Here we're seeing the address scopes. We're having here our link local. We're having only a connection. We're having here the router. Only direct connections in range. Yeah, with the link local address, they will not route it further. With mesh local, we reach our whole network with this address. And with the global, of course, we can reach the whole internet. We have used normally with a border router. When we don't have a connection to an internet, normally we don't have a global address. The link locals addresses are starting with FE80, so 16-bit, so this part doesn't change. And then, it depends on, it's normally built up from the 64-bit MAC addresses, the IPv6 address. It's quite similar to normal IPv6. The mesh local identifies the frame thread network, and it starts with FD. So we're having only 8 bits, so the two zeros here can change for a thread network. And then we can choose freely the rest of the 64 prefixes. We have only 64 because the last 64, of course, are the interface identifier. Then we're having the global addresses. For the global addresses, the three bits at the beginning are used only and starts with two and three, when I'm right, yeah. And it's then used worldwide. I have to mention that with the mesh locals, the prefix, normally in the traffic, because we reach only one mesh network in our range, and the ID from the mesh network is specified with the IEEE standard already, with the PAN ID, the short PAN ID and the extended PAN ID. So normally in our network, we don't use the mesh prefix to transfer data to save header information. It's not necessary. This is actually what 6LoWPAN does to compress the package. Here we're seeing our mesh local endpoint identifier. Here we're seeing our prefix. This is an example prefix. Like I said before, we're starting with FD and then the following bits we can choose freely, and we're having an interface identifier, for example this one here, and this become together the whole IPv6 address. This address actually we should use with our application. The airlock, which I explain in shortly, we should not use in our application. But we can also define another IP address which we want to use. This is also possible. We can add as much as as possible from our hardware or software, because, like I said before, the limitation of the resources, probably maybe 4 or 5 or something like this. The routing locator is an IP address used for the routing process. It's built from the mesh local prefix followed by a 48-bit identifier 00000FFFE00, and then followed by 16-bit, the so-called airlock 16. It's generated once the device attached to a network, but it changes also when the topology from the network changes, so we shouldn't use it by our application, since we cannot be sure that it will hold longer, this IP address. How is the airlock 16 built? The first 6-bit from the airlock 16 is a router ID. Bit 6 is reserved, and then 9 bits follow for a child ID. This means when our device is a router, then the router ID is the ID from the router itself. And when it's an end device and not a router, then the router ID is the ID from the parent. The child ID is a number from 1 to 512, and normally a child gets it from its parent. So the router parent has to manage these IDs. There we see now also our limitation of the devices. Since we're having 6 bits for the router ID, we're having 2 exponent 6 routers, which means 64 routers, but router ID 63 is reserved for Anycast locators, so would be mean 63 routers. But the default limitation is 32 from thread, which is defined in the specification. This is because we need a few numbers reserved. For example, when a read is there and we upgraded, and before we having 32 devices already inside, but one router lost the connection for a short time, we can have more than 32 IDs in the network or routers. But this is only for a short time, and also when another router having a malfunction, until all the routing tables, the ID from this router is deleted, it takes a little bit. But with this addresses, of course, the routing is quite easy. Since we're having only 32 addresses, tables are quite short. So we need only to know to which next hop we have to transfer for, let's say, router ID 30. We have to use router with the ID 2 to reach this, so the tables are not as big. The child IDs are not interested for the routing process. The algorithm which is used is RIP, which is well known already and before from routers in IP networks. It's not used now anymore, but it's just a vector distance algorithm. This was the basic concept of thread. We learned that thread is built on the IEEE 802.15.4 standard. It adds possibility for building up mesh IPv6 networks. The 6 LoPAN is the adaptation layer between IEEE and thread, that we can use the IPv6 addresses, and also the packet limitation from IEEE with 127 bytes. We learned that there are a lot of different types of devices, what a thread leader is, and a border router, and a read device. At the top, we're having here a transport layer, so UDP for sending our packages. When we want that the packages are reliable, we have to implement our acknowledgement by our own, or we're using at the application layer, another protocol. One typically is CoAP or MQTT. CoAP I will introduce you in one of the next videos, because it's quite common use this thread, even it's already implemented partly in the open thread stack, which is a three stack from Google, and a lot of companies using this stack. But first I will introduce you a short example in the next video how the thread is working with hardware. I hope you like the video, and see you next time.